In this hangout, we are going to be talking about something very important to the people of Australia as a whole, the Great Barrier Reef.
So the Great Barrier Reef has always been really important to the people of Australia and indeed the people of the world. But in 1975, the government of Australia decided to add extra protection to the Great Barrier Reef by making it a marine park. And one of the primary tools for managing and protecting the marine park and the diversity of plants and animals in it is what we call a zoning plan. Now, essentially, it just says what kind of activities can be taken in what sort of places out there in the marine park. And, of course, the main purpose of it is to protect the biodiversity. So this is actually a map of a place called the Whitsundays. Each of those different colors there represents a different zone in the zoning plan. And that essentially dictates the kinds of fishing and other activities that can take place in each area.
We've been looking at the effects of the Marine Park Zoning Plan for about the last 14 or 15 years now. In Australia and in many developing countries, we actually fish a very small proportion of the fish community. We don't tend to eat many of the herbivores on the reef, and we don't tend to eat many of the small damselfish and wrasses. We're really focused on the big predatory species. What we do see is very, very strong effects for the species of fish that we target and extract from the system.
My group's been looking at the types of diseases that affect corals on the Great Barrier Reef now for about 10 years. Here's a picture of a coral that's being affected by a disease we call skeletal eroding band. You can see a black band here at the interface between live tissue and what's exposed dead skeleton. This shows you a close-up picture under a microscope of the little ciliate. Here on this axis, we're looking at the mean prevalence of disease, what percentage of the population is affected by diseases. And you can see this dotted line represents the mean for those fished areas, and this dotted line represents the mean for these protected areas, that there's something like a fourfold decrease in the amount of disease in these protected areas. Of all the factors that we've looked at, protection from fishing was the one that explained the greatest proportion of this variability between those two different zones.
So we have in excess of 130 species of sharks and ray in the Great Barrier Reef, and we go from everything from a lot of species that are unaffected, so some of the smaller sharks and a lot of the stingrays haven't really been affected on the Great Barrier Reef and are doing really well. Then there's a whole range of species that are affected by fisheries, and they're doing variably. Some are overfished, some are doing quite well. And then there are a couple of species that are actually quite rare. Some we even suspect may be extinct on the Great Barrier Reef. You know, there's this real range of things that are going on. And the biggest pressure we know on these species in the reef is fishing, and making sure that we manage those populations well and the fishing that affects them is really what's going to help us make sure that the reef has its sharks and rays into the future. Particularly for one of the more common species on coral reefs, the grey reef shark, we actually see a very positive zoning effect. In other words, in areas that are close to fishing, there are substantially more grey reef sharks than there are in fished areas. This is a black-tipped reef shark. This is one of the common species we see, particularly in shallow coral reef areas. We've been working with this guy in a number of locations, particularly in the inshore reefs. One of the really interesting factors that we see with these animals is that while they spend a lot of time in very small areas most of the time, when they're actually teenagers, they actually go through what we call a dispersal phase, where they go from being very resident in small areas, you know, swimming, you know, 50, 100, 200 kilometres to new reef areas, probably to help sort of repopulate areas and to get away from areas of high density where they have a lot of competition from within their own species.
Look, I think some of the key factors for success are, first of all, having a really strong scientific basis for the development of any kind of marine protected area network. Working with scientists like David, Colin and Betty is absolutely essential to our ability to design and implement a zoning plan that is effective for protecting Great Barrier Reef biodiversity. And I think the second thing that's really critical is to engage with the community and educate people. There are a lot of people in Queensland and Australia more generally who have enormous value on the Great Barrier Reef. It's an Australian icon, it's an economic powerhouse, it's a global environmental icon. But we really need to engage with people, educate them what the issues are on the reef, educate them about how people impact the reef, and then educate them about how important a management tool like zoning is. so that they understand the importance of it, that they follow the rules and so on, because that compliance with a zoning plan like that is really important. And then probably, I guess, the final thing that's critical is to remember that although zoning is an incredibly important tool for protecting biodiversity, it isn't an answer to all problems. So if you've got pollution problems, you need to deal with those separately. And in particular, for all of us protecting marine areas around the world, climate change is an enormous threat.